Tim, the Mad Hatter has flipped his lid. He's running mad in Washington.
We have to protect the headwear at all the Fedora agencies.
Oh, right, and we'll make him fess up to his crimes.
That's a pithy statement. Anyway, we've got to catch him.
To the bat poles.
Welcome to the Bat Poles, Holy Hijacked Headwear. This is Tim in Tokyo with my brother Paul in Hanover, New Hampshire.
Insert hat joke.
Our theme version this time is by Joel McNeely and the Royal Scottish National Orchestra and Chorus. And it might sound familiar. Did you place where I found this? Where this came from?
No, I did not. Although it certainly sounds like, I mean, the image that appeared with the YouTube soundtrack or with the audio file is an image of a bat signal that it says something about the first three Joel Schumacher or the two Burton and the first Schumacher film, and like it's, you know, music from those films rather than the Batman theme, but it's in the style of the Elfman Batman theme.
Okay.
Orchestration.
Well, yeah, so this was on an album called The Batman Trilogy, which was released in 1997. And okay. Yeah, it contains a bunch from the two Elfman Batman soundtracks, 89 and Batman Returns, and then some Elliot Goldenthal pieces from Batman Forever. And then closes with the hefty Batman theme.
Mm-hmm.
But I found this in the closing credits of Star Trek versus Batman. I said, oh, there's a theme version I don't have. So I pulled out Shazam on my phone. And
of course. Holy once heard melody, Batman. That was the good detective work, Tim. Well, you know, I wondered at the time where it came from, and then I just completely forgot about it.
Yeah, so a little bit of a reference back to last episode.
Uh-huh. Very good, very good.
All right, so this time we are digging into the 13th Hat, several different early versions of it. This is, of course, Charles Hoffman's first script for the show and his only script from season one.
Mm-hmm.
And probably his best, because who was his script editor? Not Charles Hoffman. Lorenzo Semple Jr.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. Yeah, I have to admit that reading all of Horwitz's annotations on one of these scripts that we got from Barbara at the University of Wyoming, I was pretty surprised that Charles Hoffman ever became the story editor for the show.
Yes. I mean, a lot of Horwitz's comments really point out how Hoffman didn't quite seem to get the show. Now, of course, this is being written, or the springboard 5-page sort of mini treatment and the longer treatment were both written in December 65. So the show hadn't actually been on yet. So to some extent, it makes sense that he wouldn't quite get it. We've seen a lot of guys who were writing Batman scripts in that period who didn't get it because they hadn't seen the show.
Right, right. And the point of, you know, having these revisions and these comments was to help them and to help the staff itself of Greenway to get it, to figure out what it was that they had to get.
Yeah. So, oh, by the way, I should, as I always should mention, these scripts are all linked in the show notes.
Yes. And we do have also on the Batman 66 message board some responses to the script.
Right.
Nine or 10 are already posted there as we're recording this.
Although only three of those are really responses, but some of those are me saying when we're going to be recording. So get
Yes, of course.
And before then.
So nine minus three equals six. There are six responses.
And I had been asking if anybody had a shooting schedule for this, but apparently nobody on Earth has the shooting schedules for season one. The only document that's floating around is a cast list with their mailing addresses on it.
Right. And that information comes from Scott Sebring, correct?
That was Ben.
Okay.
Although actually we had that document already. That was why I was asking, because that wasn't what I wanted, but that's all we had. Mm-hmm. But yeah, Ben Bentley posted that. So
thanks, Ben.
Yes, thank you. So I guess we're all kind of in the same lurch as far as season one shooting schedules. I'll mention later why I was looking for that. But
Okay, good.
So let's see. First, let's get into the springboard. It has no date on it, but presumably it was December, because the treatment is dated December 13th. So this has to be before that.
Right.
And this version has a number of bits that are booted before we get to the treatment.
Mm-hmm.
This has some kind of weird things in it. So, for example, rather than the Mad Hatter having a mole named Lisa, he kidnaps a whole series of women whose names start with L. Lisa, Laura, Lorna. Because he's stealing hats, the jurors' hats. And every time he steals a hat, he encounters a screaming woman, all played by the same actress.
Mm-hmm.
And just in order to shut them up, he kidnaps them. Now, boy, you couldn't get away with that today. I mean, that would really not age well.
Well, as a running joke, it's kind of brilliant for a sitcom.
Uh-huh.
But its only point, it's like a slapstick comedy routine a bit. The point of it is the bit, rather than it having anything to do with the plot or the theme of the show.
Mm-hmm.
So, not only are they all played by the same actress, but it turns out in the end of the springboard that they're all like sisters who just happen to look a lot alike. They're not even like sextuplets. All of that is completely unrelated to anything except maybe the motif of collection, which fits well with Mad Hatter's MO.
Yeah.
But it's so gratuitous that it might be okay for a variety show or for a sitcom that, specializes in bits like that for their own sake. But Batman is not that kind of show, despite what Hoffman seems to think.
And on the board, Crispy Critter wrote, "Five women who just happen to look alike? I can see the notation. No, 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 no."
Yeah, for one thing, it would create a necessity for a completely needless five-way process shot to get the same woman onto the screen five times, unless they just want to do it through editing, which would be, as Cartman would say, lame. Or lame, as the French would say.
Right. It seems like an awful lot of work to go to for a gag that doesn't affect the story.
Yeah. And speaking of gags that don't affect the story, this is not necessarily a gag, but there's this business of one of Mad Hatter's cronies, one of his henchmen, being dissatisfied and wanting to betray the Mad Hatter.
Cappy.
That makes it all the way through to the script that we have in front of us,
the draft script with Horowitz's
annotations. But it's it doesn't fit. One of Horowitz's comments about this, and I hate to jump the gun on this, but I'm going to anyway. One of his comments about this is something to the tune of, this dilutes, to have Cappy going after and trying to overthrow Mad Hatter and take over the gang dilutes the antagonism between Batman and the Mad Hatter. You know, it ends up making that black and white opposition and that main conflict of the show into like something that has to compete with yet another division, another conflict, and that's not that's not helpful to the nature of the show as Horowitz understands it, at least. It's just too much. And I think that's smart, but it's interesting that, somebody actually tried this, I just can't imagine it working on the show, not because it just wouldn't work, but because it doesn't work for Batman, for the 66 show, because it just winds up making things way too complicated, and also it takes up too much screen time when we've got other fish to fry to take up the screen time that the kids are expecting.
Yeah, I mean, if it were 2-hour-long episodes with a cliffhanger, then you might want to introduce this kind of complication or secondary plot, but
right. But the conflict between Batman and Robin and the Mad Hatter and his gang has to be pretty cut and dried to allow for all of the kinds of scenes and the like places and, spaces that have to be shown in every episode, the necessity for the Batmobile to do things that the Batmobile does. I had completely forgotten, by the way, that there's eventually, not in the Springboard, but, down the road in the first draft, there's a let's try to steal the Batmobile scene.
Well, that happens as shot, but I don't think it's mentioned. It's not mentioned in the first draft.
No, it's not. I don't think it appears until we get. It appears in these documents until we get to the to the draft script.
No, right? It's not there mentioned. Either.
Oh, it's not? Okay.
No.
Okay, I thought it was at least mentioned in the draft. Anyway.
Now, interestingly, Hatter is only stealing the jurors' hats. He's not kidnapping the jurors, and as folks on the board also mentioned, it gives us stakes that are much too low. Now, why is Batman concerned with a series of petty thefts? And it takes them a while to dawn on Hoffman or whoever, maybe he should be kidnapping the jurors too. That would be a little bit more interesting.
Right. And in the draft script, Horowitz also has the question of exactly how the Mad Hatter is planning to, make any money off of any of this.
Right. Well, mentioned nowhere in these documents is the secondary thing of stealing the set of presidential headwear.
Yes.
It's going to be exhibited. That's where the money is coming from. But that's a completely different heist from this.
Right.
We never see anything of where he's actually in the museum trying to steal those presidential hats. It's just something additional thrown in, I'm going to get my revenge and I'm going to make some money.
Right. That's, as shot, it's just something. It's a plot, the next plot that Mad Hatter mentions is they're preparing to use the very unrealistic, skin slicers and hat maker equipment, apparently.
The hat factory.
Yeah, with the giant whirling scimitars. they're getting ready to, turn Batman and Robin into fezzes, David Wayne, delightedly says.
Now, we do have, from the beginning, the jury box full of mannequins. And then a 13th one for Batman on the witness stand. So, yeah, that's there from the beginning. I liked the note in the Springboard, Bruce and Dick are dabbling in some educational hobby. That's definitely right for the cold open part.
Yes, and that could mean anything from, playing chess to ornithology to, fishing and brushing your teeth down at the creek while camping and, learning the ways of the naturalist. So, yeah, that's pretty dead on.
Now, another thing interesting about the Springboard is that it contains elements of the contaminated cowl.
Yes.
Batman has appointments at both the sculptor studio and the atomic energy lab. Mm-hmm. So apparently at some point, it's gone by the treatment. So apparently he decided, well, it's a little bit too much. Let's take that out and save it for later.
Mm-hmm.
So now there is a sculptor who is German at this point, and we'll get into later why he became French. It is
yes.
mentioned in a note, but mm-hmm. At this point he is Wolfgang Brumer in all of these documents, not mm-hmm. Octave Marbeau. Now, when Batman goes to the studio and Hatter, masquerading as Brumer, asks him to remove his cowl in the back room, he actually does so. Where mm-hmm. on the show, he doesn't. He finds Marbeau in the closet, and they come back out with his. He's still wearing his cowl. Mm-hmm. But in this version, Robin takes the cowl out to the fake Brumer, who's trying to run off with it. But, you know, the real no-no of this is that Batman in the side room, after he's taken off his cowl, finds Brumer tied up, and you know, but he's not Batman. He's Bruce Wayne in a Batman costume, and you know, you never, ever, ever see that on the show.
That's right, and also he's, you know, opened himself up to being discovered, unless at that point he's wearing the beret with the holes cut in it that he was supposed to wear in the
right. When
is
he
that in the treatment?
When he comes out after the Hatter, I think that's actually here in the springboard.
Okay.
Batman comes out with a beret with eye holes it's pulled down over his face to face off with the disguised Mad Hatter.
I would let him get away with it if only it were a raspberry beret, you know, the kind you find at a secondhand store.
Right. But yeah, apparently Brumer now knows who Batman is.
How could he not? Just thinking about the massive complications here. The pretty female scientist in the nuclear lab on page 4 of the springboard, who's played by the same actress.
Yeah.
Whose name is Lena. Then mm-hmm. top of 5, Batman and the others wait for a minute and then discover the ruse, but Batman is one up on the Mad Hatter this time. The radioactive cowl isn't his real one. It's a substitute, which he wore both at Brumer's and here at the atomic lab in case the Mad Hatter jumped him and got away with it.
Right. Well, we didn't mention that Hatter had used the radioactive spray on the cowl mm-hmm. and because he wanted to have Batman to have to remove the cowl again so that Hatter could get it.
Right.
But yeah, like it was not the real cowl. What?
Yeah. I mean, that stuff winds up in, you know, in Hoffman's script for the contaminated cowl and the Mad Hatter runs afoul. But as you mentioned, but here it's just like, you know, Hoffman is trying to, seems like, you know, pick up some version of Batman's ability to think, you know, two steps ahead of the crooks, which uh-huh. comes up in lots of episodes. But, you know, like the cowl switcheroo, it's just way too confusing and too subtle.
Hmm. Well, so what makes the cowl that he was wearing fake?
Yeah.
It's a cowl. I mean, he's wearing it as Batman.
They're not actually part of his freaking body. So the counterfeit cowl? Should that have been the name of this episode?
I mean, he could say it was a spare. That would make a little bit more sense.
Right, right. Maybe it was a Ben Franklin Halloween mask with Batman
that
in a
could
big,
be.
You know, forehead, you know, chevron stamped in the middle of his head.
Yeah, like one of us used to wear.
Yes.
In the springboard, there really isn't a death trap or even really a cliffhanger.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Batman and Robin go to the lab. Scientist says the cowl's getting radioactive, better take it off and get decontaminated. And at the same time, Laura joins the other tied-up girls in the cell-like room. The end of part one.
Yeah, yeah, Batman will have to remove his cowl, so you can just imagine, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, and he's slowly, slowly lifting his cowl up over his, you know, up over his Adam's apple, and then up over his jawline, and then up mm-hmm. over the bottom of his chin.
And, you know, that would not have flown, because we know that Dozier didn't really like the cliffhanger in the first Joker, because it was mm-hmm. just about secret identity rather than life and limb.
Right, right. And then, of course, you know, the lawsuit wasn't the only the only part of the cliffhanger in High Diddle Riddle, because of the, you know, the plastic surgery moment where it looks as though Gorshin is going to slice up Burt Ward's face.
Yeah.
But nevertheless, this is definitely not Dozier's cup of tea.
One other unforgivable sin of this springboard late in the document, Batman borrows a Geiger counter. What? He doesn't have a superior Geiger counter in his belt?
Yeah, that's labeled as such.
Yeah. Bat Geiger counter.
Bat superior Geiger counter. Bat better than yours Geiger counter.
Yeah, I mean, that's not resourcefulness, really, if you just have to borrow stuff you need.
Although it is nice that in the final version, you know, this version as shot, and I guess in this, in the this draft as well, it's mentioned, but in the final version as shot, we get this lovely yellow, like, stick of Wrigley's gum. It looks like that's stamped, you know, Bat Sonic Tracer or whatever it is, that Alfred tries to, you know, place in the bowling alley manager's hat.
Right.
But I love that thing. I mean, you know, not only is it huge, but it also is, like, you know, minutely engraved with everything that it is, so that if criminal finds it, they'll know that they need to stomp on it instead of just putting it back in the hat.
And then, as you mentioned, the various identical women are all sisters who happen to look a lot alike and, quote, are all completely gaga over Batman. Yes, it's season one.
Yes, it is. Oh, Batman. Except that's not from season one.
No.
Okay, so the springboard, interesting document. It's a springboard that if it were in my... we have a swimming pool in New Hampshire for some reason. It just happened that... You know, this was the house that came on the market. The price was right. And now we have a swimming pool, which we never really wanted, although our son loves it. But if this springboard were the diving board in our pool, if you jumped on it, it would send you over the fence and back into the woods rather than into the pool. So it is a springboard, but where it takes you is not quite in the direction of a Batman episode.
Yes, apt comparison.
Jack Kirby's 1960s Marvel Comics work with Stan Lee created some of the most fondly remembered comics of the 20th century. If you're like us, you probably know about his early 1970s work for DC, but you've read little or none of it. Here at Deconstructing Comics, Emmett and I decided to change that. We've launched into a series of episodes in which we read all of Kirby's Fourth World, from the first appearance of Darkseid in Jimmy Olsen's book, to the long-delayed finale, The Hunger Dogs. What we found is unrestrained creativity that's a bit rough around the edges. This is Tim. Join us as we visit the Wild Area, the planets of New Genesis and Apocalypse, plus good old Metropolis, as we read Jimmy Olsen, The Forever People, New Gods, and Mr. Miracle. We're at DeconstructingComics.com or look for Deconstructing Comics wherever you find your podcasts.
Are you addicted to classic TV shows? Did you spend the 80s sitting in front of the boob tube? Then join us for TV Tangents, where we examine television of the 20th century with barely any contemporary context. Visit Shout Engine, Apple Podcasts, Google Play, or wherever you get your podcasts, and look for TV Tangents.
Okay, let's move on to the treatment. 22 pages, dated December 13th, 1965. It mentions supered titles here and there, and we'll come back to that when we get to the first draft.
Mm-hmm.
And as we discussed in the Bat Inbox last time, the early scripts refer to supered titles, but they had done away with that by the time they started making the show. Mad Hatter now has a hidden bulb in his vest that squirts a stream of knockout gas from the rim of his top hat. But Hoffman keeps using the words squirt and squish, which make it seem like it's liquid rather than gas.
Yeah, and then zing, which sounds as though it's electrical. So perhaps that was the spark, so to speak, that got us to the hat with the evil eyes, you know, that zap with animated electricity, the victim. Mm.
Yeah, Crispy Critter wrote on the board, by the way, Charles, sleeping gas goes psht, not zing.
Zing went the strings of my sleeping gas.
Hatter is still not kidnapping the jurors, just stealing the hats. Identical cousins are...
Holy Patty Duke show!
They are gone. There are now non-identical women who catch Hatter stealing hats, but instead of kidnapping them, he's spraying them with knockout gas.
Right, right. At least his hat is involved the
springboard.
Well, no, I was thinking of, you know, what would you call it? His device, his
the mesmerizer.
I was thinking at this point it's not the mesmerizer, so they're, you know, trying to figure out some way of incorporating his mode of kidnapping people with his hat.
His shtick. Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly. So they're working on that.
The document mentions anticipation that the hat thefts are leading to a greater crime, but within this document, no greater crime ever materializes. So I wasn't sure why that was mentioned, if there wasn't actually a greater crime.
Well, I believe the greater crime is the script so far. that's the most unforgivable crime of all.
Well, I think we've seen worse, but...
Yes, we have. And this... You know, watching the episode, I watched the second episode more carefully than the first in the, you know, the final versions, the shot versions, before we started recording this. But it certainly did get salvaged as an arc.
Oh, yeah.
In the end, I think quite well.
The something educational has become Bruce and Dick unwrapping a new piece of statuary. And of course, that's as broadcast.
Mm-hmm.
Mad Hatter now has henchmen, and as you mentioned, one is Cappy, who at this point likes caps, but Hatter considers caps inferior to hats, and thus he sees Cappy as a second-class citizen. Hoffman goes on, Cappy is aware of this, and though he feigns fidelity to the Mad Hatter, we suspect there just might be a forthcoming split in the ranks, which we'll use later. So there's the conflict within the bad guy camp.
Right, right. Prejudice against Cappy Americans.
Now, of course, by the time we get to shooting this, that conflict has been downgraded to Cappy repeatedly demanding to know when they're going to eat.
Before we get to the next victim, when do we get to the next meal? Getting bonnets for these dummies ain't filling our stomachs, boss.
Which turns this into an episode of Scooby-Doo. At least for all intents and purposes.
Yeah, he needs some Cappy snacks.
Yes, and they need to be, then that means the henchmen need to be like all bloodshot and, you know, bloodshot-eyed and paranoid as well.
Mm-hmm. Since
Shaggy is, you know, perhaps the first stoner on Saturday morning television.
Right. Lisa is now, quote, obviously the Mad Hatter's assistant, if not something more intriguing, which you could say about pretty much any mall in the show.
Yeah, but in a word,
I mean, you know, they're not often terribly overt. I mean, I guess it depends. Some are a little bit more overt, like Egghead,
mm-hmm.
where it's pretty clear that there's hanky-panky going on.
Mm-hmm.
But in this case, yeah, I mean, there's no obvious hint of romance, but you just kind of suspect that, yeah, they might be...
Mm-hmm.
More than friends,
right? Or the Joker goes to school with the Mexican perfume and all that, and Susie.
So Mad Hatter's Hat Factory speech is outlined. It's including the Tam O'Shanter, so you can see some of what's broadcast there. And Lisa works at Magda's Millinery Maison.
Mm-hmm.
That's all pretty much as shot now. Hoffman envisions Batman and Robin racing across town to try and reach the millinery shop before the Mad Hatter can pounce again in a series of giddy emergency bat turns, parenthesis, stock, I hope, and parenthesis, stunning bat stops, breathtaking near bat misses in tunnels and at railroad crossings. Who's shoot? How are you going to shoot all this? And why would they ever need to do more than one emergency bat turn?
Yeah. Well, Batman's bat sense of direction was somewhat bat-addled.
Yeah, just call him wrong way Batman.
Yeah, I mean, this would seem to suggest that Batman can't drive, rather than suggesting excitement and thrills. So, you know, the point of the Batmobile is to be shown driving really fast thanks to undercranking and then, you know, cut to wherever they're going. That's what it does.
Right. But yeah, just also, I just smell cost overrun.
Oh, yes. And I can even hear the Benny Hill theme in the background. Yakety sax, ahoy.
Let's see. So, yeah, now Batman smells a rat at the sculptors before he removes his cowl. So he doesn't. Mm-hmm. Cappy dumps a bucket of plaster on Batman's head rather than that whole shoot of plaster. So it sounds pretty insufficient for what's supposed to happen as the cliffhanger.
That's right. It won't mummify him the way Batman is mummified in the opening of the next episode.
Yeah. Now, Batman gets out of the plaster by presciently collecting small pieces of brass from the floor of the sculptor's dressing room, saying, "If small pieces of metal are placed in salient points of a wet plaster mold, either from within or without, they not only leave small air holes, but provide divisions whereby removing the sections of the solid cast becomes simpler." And the kid, you've lost the kids by that point.
Oh, yeah. So much more economical simply to have Batman say, "I held my breath."
Which doesn't happen until after the first draft.
That's right. I was thinking, too, that that's also a lot more, I don't know, bat enviable, I guess. You know, it's like, ooh, you know, kids can totally get into the idea of, you know, somebody could hold their breath for that long must really be like, you know, incredibly well developed human being. Whereas, you know, the pieces of metal, it's like,
now the what now?
why is Batman using a metal detector in this place? I don't get it. And why did that save him?
Shouldn't he be on the beach in his bat shorts?
Did he put them all in his mouth and then spit them into the plaster as it was falling on his head?
Yeah, and he's wandering around the sculptor's studio thinking, you know, I might get a bunch of plaster dumped on me, so I better pick up these little copper things.
Yeah. Right. Having him, deal with a disaster like this by improvising based on skills he already has seems a lot more likely. Mm-hmm. It's not realistic, but it is, you know, it's a little more verisimilitudinous. You can imagine it in the world of this show.
In part two, we have a character called Silk Dunbar, who later becomes Turkey Bowwinkle. And by the way, I need to bring the attention of fandom.com and Joel Eisner to this. It's not Bullwinkle. It's not the moose.
It's Bowwinkle.
And you can see that in the actual closing credits of part two. You don't need to get the scripts from Laramie to find that out.
That's right. Hey, Rocky, watch me pull a rabbit out of a hat.
Well, we got the hat.
Turkey, that trick never works. Watch me pull a bat tracer out of a hat.
Yeah, exactly. After the hat factory fight, Cappy sprays Mad Hatter with sulfuric acid, hoping to wipe him out and take over the gang. Now, I don't know why he would bother to do this in the presence of Batman, but it's like, right. He's going to spray it on Batman, too.
And who's the gang? The other guy?
I guess. Well, I'm not sure how many henchmen Hoffman is envisioning here.
Well, he's not envisioning them on the page, that's for sure.
Okay, so let's look at this first draft. And now the front page of it has a bunch of notes on it, presumably from Howie Horowitz, because it is stamped, received Howie Horowitz.
January 1st of 66.
Yeah, well, that's actually a 5, isn't it? At least it looks like it to me. I mean, it's wrong if it's a 5, but it also must be wrong because what's typed on here by Hoffman is first draft January 3rd, 1966. So, right. So the stamper is doubly wrong, I think.
Where do you see a five? Tim?
Well, maybe
it's
just
January 1st, 1965. No, it says 66. I can see the six at the end there.
Okay, well, maybe just some of the ink didn't quite get there, but it makes it look like a five to me.
Well, I printed it, and it does show me the six.
Okay,
faintly, well, but it's definitely a six.
Yeah, I don't know. I printed it, too, but it still looks like a five to me anyway. I could imagine, you know, the new year, somebody forgot to change the five to a six would quite possibly happen. But
either way, it's two. They received it 2 days before it was submitted,
right,
according to this.
Right. Either 2 days or a year in 2 days.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when I was looking these up on the American Heritage website, there was a script that was called The 13th Hat, and there was another one that was called The Mad Hatter Runs Amok. And they were both dated the same time. And I thought, well, what the what? Is this a completely different story? Well, actually, one was unannotated and the other one was annotated. And someone had crossed out the 13th hat on this one and written in The Mad Hatter Runs Amok.
Right.
So.
Something else is scratched out here, too, so that Runs Amok is written above it. The Mad Hatter counts.
Goes berserk, I think it says. It printed up pretty faintly here. I'm not quite sure. I think that I do see berserk there.
Right, but it looks like it says counts goes berserk. I can't figure out what that first word might be.
Huh.
Anyway, but what do you suppose they were planning to rhyme with amok? I can only think of one word right now, and it's not TV safe.
Mad Hatter's fire truck.
That sounds like my 12-year-old son's favorite joke. What starts with F ends with K, and I can't remember the rest of the trick, the rest of the joke. But of course, the punchline is fire truck.
Okay, well, let's look at all of these notes. So now I'm going to come back to this later, but I just want to point out this upper left note: need 2 days without Bruce and Dick or Batman and Robin. Interesting. That this is the reason that I wanted to look at a shooting schedule to
absolutely
see if I could find those 2 days when they're not there. But unfortunately, that document doesn't seem to be available. Then there's need something better than just a gun for Mad Hatter. He's still got the knockout gas in this first draft.
That makes unusual sounds.
The mesmerizer is not around yet. Next to that, what does that say? Set and cast
list, please.
Please. Yeah, okay. Need Batcave scene in part one.
Absolutely. Over on the left, we have more Lisa throughout. We've lost her.
Yeah. Yeah, well, that's definitely true. You can see where Lisa is added in a lot if you compare to what's shot.
Yeah, and without her, how could we, in the recap at the beginning of the second episode, where would we be without a dish? Another dish.
Yeah, Lisa is another dish.
Mm-hmm.
In part one, more should happen in regards to parallel plot. I'm not quite sure what parallel plot he's referring to. Is that the Cappy thing?
I wondered about that as well. Maybe the parallel plot is if the main plot is Batman and Robin are trying to apprehend the Mad Hatter, the parallel plot would be the Mad Hatter's plan, I think.
Mm-hmm.
So the Mad Hatter's plan to either, you know, steal the hats and kidnap the jurors or just steal their hats. But I can see where Horowitz or staff are coming from here, and that plot is still not completely developed into something that could allow Batman in the second episode of the arc to, like, of course, you know, how could I have been so stupid? As he actually, smacks himself in the head in the Batcave once the Batcomputer figures it out. I wasn't thinking, though, why are they so stupid? I was thinking, why didn't they use the Batcomputer right away? But, you know, that would be not very suspenseful, and it would also mean the plot would be over in about 15 minutes.
Yeah. Then we have Bill. Explain to Charles, no more super titles except at end of first show. All narration. So that decision has been made by this point.
Right. The brackets are around where the super titles do go, and they only go like superimposed over footage of Batman and or Robin struggling against the trap.
Yeah. The impersonation of Broomer has to be done cleverly, needs some kind of shtick. Of course, Broomer is the sculptor at this point.
Do you think they achieved a stick? A shtick? A stick. Speak softly and carry a big shtick. That's what a Catskill comedian must do.
Well,
Well, I mean, he's got the French artist shtick rather than the German artist shtick, which is not quite so familiar.
Well, I don't know if it's a shtick exactly. There is a gag as it's shot where he calls in his henchmen while he's disguised, and he accidentally starts speaking in the French accent to them and then stops himself.
Right, right.
The moment has finally arrived. Batman's cowl at last.
That's kind of sticky.
That might have come from this note, I don't know. And then need dialogue polish with a lot more of our, quote, campy, unquote, dialogue. And High C had a comment about this.
Yes, this was a good one.
The reference to our campy dialogue makes me think this is being edited post High Diddle Riddle debut. So it'll be after January 12th and 13th of 66. And they already are taking their cues from the reviews and the word of mouth. So much for Dozier's non-camp protests to the contrary at the time.
Mm-hmm.
Horwitz's ideas to expand Lisa's role and to lose Hatter's gun for something more, quote, Batman-y, unquote, were good. Kudos to him. As Clavier Ankh on the board has said, Diane McBain's performance as Lisa is one of the better mall portrayals of the first season.
Yes, indeed. And she also has more to do than a lot of malls, although, you know, more on par with other malls of season one compared to like season two and especially season three malls. But she's, you know, pretty integral to the plot in that she actually goes to see Bullwinkle at the bowling alley and, you know, tries to hoodwink him into showing her the hat via mail mode.
Yeah,
the men's fashion magazine for which she supposedly works, and that's in this draft, right? The male mode stuff.
No, it's not.
Oh, it's not. Okay.
No. Well, we'll get to that. That's an interesting point. The teaser at the beginning of the script, it's kind of the same robberies that we see as shot, but in a different order. It starts with the silver shop, and there's no kidnapping. It's just stealing hats.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have Gordon and O'Hara. It's basically the same scene. Of course, there are always dialogue adjustments, and they had to add the references to the kidnapping as shot, which are not here.
Mm-hmm.
And then the unwrapping of the statue, that's all pretty much the same. We go the extra mile on this show. So I noticed that when Bruce and Dick are making a birdwatching excuse to run off and be Batman and Robin, as written, Bruce mentions a black-footed albatross, and that's the only bird that comes up. And for some reason, they added Dick mentioning a fork-tailed petrel.
They just called to report they sighted a black-footed albatross at Slater's Slough.
And maybe a fork-tailed petrel.
Where is Gotham City?
Well, it's supposedly New York, right?
Well, a lot of the stock footage would indicate that. But when I happened to look this up to find out how to spell petrel, which is P-E-T-R-E-L, I found both of these birds live in the Pacific. So there's a California bias, I think, to choosing the birds that they should watch.
Yes, they might even be able to pick one up on camera if they're lucky.
Yeah, in New York or Chicago, I don't think they're going to find these birds.
No, probably not. Not even a yellow-bellied sapsucker, but that's a different show.
Right. Well, of course, they're not actually going out to watch birds anyway, so they could mention any old darn bird they want to.
Yeah, for sure. Tim, before we move on, there's something on page 3 I wanted to mention. Whoever made this particular annotation was right on target in terms of cutting costs and being more economical with screen time as well. O'Hara and police brass react further to Gordon, you know, saying that, you know, the Jervis Tetch slash the Mad Hatter must be behind this. But O'Hara and police brass react further, ad-libbing simultaneously, Jervis Tetch? It's not much of an ad-lib if they, if the line's actually here in the script. But setting that aside, the cross-out is has been that's been crossed out and replaced by O'Hara. Jervis Tetch? It's, who else, why else would you, why would you need anybody else to say that? And why would you need anybody else in the room for that matter? Since,
well,
you know, since O'Hara is, you know, metonymizes the entire GCPD whenever he's sitting around and, or standing around in Gordon's office.
Right. But remember how crowded that office is in High Diddle Riddle.
Sure. Yes.
And,
well,
and
that's,
I think that's maybe the original envisioning of it, that there are a lot of cops standing around, but, you know, the budget rears its ugly head, and pretty soon it's just O'Hara.
Well, also, I don't think it's necessary to have every cop in Gotham or every cop police brass in Gotham in there. That's just a way of emphasizing the stakes in the first episode.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, after that, you know, just having Gordon there, it's not just, I mean, it's certainly about, like, you know, cutting back on the extras and cutting down on speaking parts.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's also just, you know, it's not necessary after you've done it once.
Yeah, I suppose so. And yeah, Inspector Bash gone. Always wonder, like, what did Semple think Inspector Bash was going to do?
Good question. Perhaps have a Bash Pow fight with Batman and Robin.
I mean, how is he going to out detect the world's greatest detective?
Yeah, I mean, that sounds like another rivalry that would end up, you know, presenting a kind of, you know, putting the brakes on the main conflicts of the episodes, kind of like having, you know, the hench people against their bosses, as Cappy was supposed to be in the original Springboard.
Mm-hmm.
I like, on page four, I like the decision to cut out Bruce saying about the sculpture, it wasn't easy outbidding other collectors, because we know that despite the fact that he's a multimillionaire, Bruce Wayne does not care about money. So he, and he also doesn't care about defeating other collectors, you know, and showing his financial prowess by outbidding them. So instead, cutting out that line means that line concentrates entirely on Bruce's enchantment by the sculpture and by the artist, rather than making this about his cash and his ability to throw his weight around.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and when I printed this out, some of the handwriting came out kind of light, but I was just noticing on page 7 where Gordon says, at this rate, Gotham City will soon be without a single piece of headgear, and it's been written in, exact line was used in teaser. So so Hoffman's like recycling his lines already on page 7.
Well, nobody's going to watch the teaser anyway. Is that what he was thinking? The kids will be too busy having their Flintstones vitamins dispensed at that point and won't have sat down in front of the set yet. Oh, top of 8, Gordon, you've had previous experience with the Mad Hatter, Batman. Batman, indeed I have. I testified at his last trial. He's probably never forgotten that. Note, annotation, awkward dialogue, it's obvious. What is the it there? What is obvious? That he's had previous experience with the Mad Hatter? Or has this mention of the Batman testifying at his trial, is that redundant at this point?
Yeah, I wasn't quite sure what they were getting at there either. It does get changed a shot to Robin saying, when you testified at his trial.
Mm-hmm.
But when you testified against him at his last trial, he said he'd get you if it was the last thing he ever did.
Few men die of threats, Robin.
But I'm not quite sure what the problem was there.
Mm-hmm.
I did like the change where Robin says he said he'd get you if it was the last thing he did. And it's written, Batman shrugs, it may be. Which, as shot, was changed to few men die of threats, Robin.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
It's a lot more Batman-esque line. Page 9 is, you mentioned this already, but Batman, as written here, says, the boy Wonder and I would like to nail this wily weasel ourselves. He's an old enemy of mine, and there may be more to this than meets the eye. And Horwitz has written in, wrong. Batman is never interested in revenge, only crime fighting.
Yes, that's beautiful.
And so it's changed as shot to a line about rehabilitating the Mad Hatter.
Absolutely, yes. Did you notice, too, there's a very light annotation on page 8 when Batman shrugs and says it may be. The annotation is too bloodthirsty a line for Batman. Mm. You know, suggesting, you know, kind of the, it's the harbinger to the kind of revenge line. I can't wait to mix it up again with the Mad Hatter. It's like, that's not why Batman does what he does. It may be why Batman in the comics does what he does. You could say that, you know, everything that Batman does in the comics is revenge for his parents' death, even though he's, you know, not avenging himself specifically on the criminal who killed them. He's avenging himself on crime, but
Now, except I was, when I read that line, Boy Wonder and I would like to nail this Wily Weasel ourselves. He's an old enemy of mine. I was thinking, is it revenge or is it a sense of responsibility that I need to take care of this because I didn't get it right the last time? Or,
well, I'm not sure Batman would think that, though, because, you know, he did have a jury trial, and Batman certainly, you know, respects the law and the judicial system, you know, almost to a fault. But nevertheless, Wily Weasel has the connotation of suggesting a kind of, you know, willingness to mix it up with this guy just for the sake of, you know, taking him out for the pleasure of punching him in the hat.
So then we get a long paragraph about Mad Hatter's hideout, and it mentions the henchmen, Cappy and Dicer. Those are the names that were used as shot. But Cappy is a sly dwarf-like, that's crossed out, little man wearing a brightly checked oversized cap. Dicer, less important to us, wears a derby. The Mad Hatter steps back to admire his latest acquisition. Now, as written here, Lisa is barely in this scene, and she pops in at the end, where instead she's, you know, his major interlocutor in the hat factory scene and, you know, saying, oh, you pixie, and stuff like that.
Oh, dear.
And this for shrinking and sizing hat bodies. But why not shrink and size the body of Batman himself?
Oh, my heart leaps with joy when I think that one day my dastardly adversary may end up as a hat brim or crown or even a tassel on a tam-o'-shanter.
A tam-o'-shanter! Oh, you pixie!
And she mentions working at Madame Magda's. By the way, did you recognize Dicer?
No. Holy deja vu?
Holy multiple roles for the same actor in different episodes. Gil Perkins. He's most recognizable as the jury foreman in Jokes on Catwoman.
Oh, okay.
He's also Cauliflower in Ring Around the Riddler and also a henchman in The Joker's Wild.
Wow.
So he's a four-time henchman.
How many times did he play Guy at Sandwich Counter in Surfside 6? Or 77 Sunset Strip? Bottom of page 10, the Mad Hatter's line goes like this. Our wallets will be well filled, Dicer, when I complete the gestures off screen. Most fantastic hat clutch of my glorious career. And that's been replaced by hat snatch of my glorious career, which, you know, makes for the, you know, the mention of the hat snatch in the teaser right after Dish. And I think we've commented on the, you know, the innuendo of mentioning dishes and snatch.
Another dish and another snatch.
But beyond that, I've got Ted Nugent in my head now against my will because I've got hat snatch fever.
Pointing to that, there's a note on the next page. How will this fill their wallets? He should say he has a plan for making a lot of money, but shouldn't reveal what it is. But actually, he does reveal it. It's the presidential headwear.
Right, right.
But that's not till the final.
But at this point, he's just got hat snatch fever, and that's the end of it.
And we've got Mad Hatter insulting Caps and Cappy on page 11. When Cappy is saying many others have tried killing Batman, Mad Hatter says, what kind of a brain have you got under that derisive again, oversized dinky?
Good Lord.
Can you say that on TV?
Holy piles of innuendo upon other piles of innuendo. Many others do not have the lethal equipment in my hat factory. You know, that looks like a bat trap factory to me rather than a hat factory. I'm just going to say it out loud. It's really just there to, like, you know, chop the living daylights out of, you know, guys wearing costumes.
Yeah, you wouldn't get very good fur coats running the animals through that assortment of knives.
No, there's nothing very precise about, you know, your skinning of, let's say, a beaver to make, you know, a beaver fur hat of just a bunch of scimitars spinning around in a circle. It doesn't really work.
So on page 13, we get the first mention of kidnapping. Now, he doesn't actually start doing kidnapping yet, but Mad Hatter says, the biggest coup of all, substituting the real owners of these hats for the 12 wax dummies in this jury box. Cappy, aghast. You mean kidnapping 12 jurors? Mad Hatter nods wickedly and asking the biggest ransom Gotham City has ever seen. And then there's a written in note, should we hold this out a while? So far, this is a long talking scene.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, kidnapping ends up being in here from the very beginning as shot.
Right. That would certainly save some time as the episode, or some talking as well as the episode unfurls.
The last part of the scene gets cut on page 14. As shot, it ends with, don't worry, my dear, it'll all be so simple. But Hatter goes on and on after that in the script. The Mad Hatter will be recognized before he heists Magda's hat. This will give the police time to alert my foremost enemy, Batman, when he and the Boy Wonder appear in the salon, etc., etc., etc.
Expository, expository, expository. I'll rule the world.
The scene goes on to the next page, and that's where it's written, we're giving too much away. Where Mad Hatter says, don't worry, my dear, it will all be so simple. The Mad Hatter will be recognized before he... Okay, this is the same page, actually. Okay.
Yeah, it is printed twice, apparently, in the original, because these annotations only appear on the second copy of page 14.
Mm-hmm. Yes. But, yeah, that's where he says we're giving too much away. And then at the bottom, we've got Cappy talking to the camera, and Horowitz has written no, and... Heisey and I both thought of John S. Drew nodding approvingly at that no.
Yes, yes. Appearing in a, you know, kind of spirit-like nimbus over Horowitz's head, nodding his approval. Yes, Howie. Yes, Howie.
The future spirit of John S. Drew, who I believe wasn't born yet at the time. I think he's about your age.
Yes, well, spirits, you know, they're timeless. Anyway.
Yeah. And on the next page, Cappy is moaning, you know, a demented genius, luring us to our doom, too. That's what he's saying to the camera.
Very silly.
Now, then we've got the foyer at the convention hall and the hat check girl, Babette.
Now, perhaps if you started again, Miss...
Babette. People call me Babette. That's my name.
Now, the script says nothing about her having adenoid problems. I don't know whose idea that was. I'm Babette.
I'm Badish. I remember I'm put in the mind of, for some reason, you know, haven't read this since it was in a scholastic book and when I was in grade school, but the original novel of Freaky Friday, where, you know, Boris makes a beetloaf. And, hi, I'm Boris, and I'm going to make you a beetloaf. Well, apparently he was going to make a meatloaf, but it turns out he has adenoids or, you know, a cold or something.
And his name was actually Morris, as I recall.
That's right. But he was actually making a beetloaf, I think. It's just that it was impossible to tell.
Right. Yeah, he wasn't saying, I'm Boris, I'm going to make a meatloaf. He was saying, I'm Morris, I'm going to make a beetloaf. Right. Okay. Folks, if you want good Freaky Friday, read the book. The Jodie Foster movie, well, was completely spoiled by the promos, as I recall. And I never saw the remake. But the
novel is so much better.
Yes. Although the original movie did have John Astin in it.
Yes, that's true. Not smelling his armpit, though.
No.
I know, that's not really what he was doing, nevertheless.
On page 16, when they're talking with Babette, and as shot, the fireman comes in and says, your bat phone is buzzing. In here, the bat phone sets off a bat rocket. So, yeah, I don't know. That doesn't seem very... I mean, what happens to the bat rocket then? They might blow up a building or something.
Yeah, I was going to say, Batman gets phone call, comma, kills 12. Story at 11.
And a much smaller bat rocket than the one in Star Trek versus Batman, but...
Right.
It's not a NASA moon launch rocket. But.
That's right.
Let's see. We've got a note adding that the hat that Magda puts on Miss Maud Eagle should be outrageously silly.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the script calls for clerks and other customers joining in the confusion at Magda's. What clerks and other customers? I guess they couldn't afford any.
Extras.
Now, since he's still not kidnapping people... after the theft of the hat, Magda talks with Batman. But since she's kidnapped as shot, then instead Batman talks with Mrs. Monteagle.
Mm-hmm.
And she flirts with him. Now, there was this note in here, dull dialogue. Let's get some typical square Batman answers.
Mm-hmm.
Closer angle, Batman, Robin, and Magda. Lisa and Mrs. Monteagle in immediate background. Batman, are you all right, Madam Magda? Magda, I'm still woozy from the knockout gas, feels her hair, and my favorite hat is gone. Batman, it will be returned, don't worry, we are on to this cagey culprit. During this, Magda recovers her vivacious aplomb to the point she eyes his cowl with interest. Magda, I've always loved your cowl. I might modify the design and start a whole new fashion. Mrs. Monteagle, angled in. I'll take a dozen, in assorted colors. Magda, you must find it a little warm in summer, though. Batman, I'm never without it, winter or summer. I wouldn't know. Magda, pointedly, but you must take it off sometime. All of Gotham City wonders who you really are, Batman. Batman, they might be quite disappointed. Magda, eyes flutter. Such a shy, sweet boy.
Oh, Batman, am I glad to see you. I'm Hermione Monteagle.
How do you do?
Oh, there's been a kidnapping and a hatnapping, both right in this place right now.
Alarming indeed.
And poor Madame Magda, they stole her right under my very eyes. Oh, I don't know what the world's coming to. My, I simply love that cowl. You know, I'm sure the communists had something to do with this.
I suspect the culprit can be found closer to home, Mrs. Monteagle.
Hermione?
Yeah, Batman's dialogue is just kind of there. You know, like he's just trying to make small talk rather than taking this as an opportunity to kind of preach civic responsibility in some way.
Mm-hmm. Now, I thought this was interesting. So, as it's written... After Lisa gives them the business card of the sculptor,
mm-hmm.
Batman and Robin have a conversation there in the hat shop, where as shot, they go to the Batcave and have the conversation there, as they so often do. I mean, it's not like it's way out of the way or anything. Let's just go to the Batcave and talk a few minutes and then leave again and go back into Gotham City. Holy wasted fuel.
It's only 14 miles.
But I think, you know, maybe there was a need for a little more privacy, maybe, you know, rather than having a conversation about their investigation right there in the hat shop.
Yes, I suppose so. Also, it's a chance to show the Batcave, which is something that is mentioned in the notes that there needs to be
right.
A Batcave scene in
right.
part one.
Yeah, that's probably what's motivating it.
So, did you see this on 21? Magda says to Batman, I'm sure you don't remember me, but I'll never forget your brilliant testimony at the trial of that detestable little Jervis Tetch. And Horowitz has written in, so how come she didn't recognize Jervis when he just stole her hat? Good catch.
Well, the fact that she's gone and Mrs. Monteagle is there instead solves that problem.
Sure, of course.
In that added Batcave scene, at this point is when they plot out the sites of the thefts on the lighted Lucite map of Gotham City.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I think in the script that they look at the map, but I think it happens a little bit later. But as shot, the locations of the thefts end up forming the shape of a top hat.
Yes.
And mm-hmm. I thought, and Theron of Andor also posted this on the board, as a kid, I remember being perplexed that when Batman added the locations of each hat robbery to his Bat Lucite map of Gotham City and connected the dots, they coincidentally made the pattern of a large top hat. Now, if Mad Hatter had been stealing any old hats, that would make sense that he would plant this clue to taunt Batman. But these were 12 targeted jurors who just happened to live or work in a pattern of a top hat? Yes, I had the same thought. It doesn't make any sense. And it's...
But perhaps he had them evicted secretly, like, you know, posing as the, you know, Gotham City Council or something. He had them all evicted from their old homes and had them placed in new locations that would, you know, form the shape of a top hat on a map.
The most charitable thing I can do is once again cite John S. Drew, Gotham City logic.
Right, right. Things express what they are in every way possible.
Now, this is, I guess, outside of Magda's shop, or outside, this is outside the studio? No. Where are we? Page 22.
Hmm.
They continue out toward Batmobile, camera angling to Lisa, who moves after them toward the door of the shop and watches them go with a little smile of a dirty job well done. Super title. Can it be possible Batman's fallen for this ruse? And Horowitz has written in too many exteriors.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I think that one does get in. But, yeah, I think, again, we're thinking about money here.
Right. And on page 23, he writes about shots 56 and 58. Another exterior and too many one-shots.
One-shots meaning what?
Meaning a shot of a single character.
Okay. Batman and Robin get out of the Batmobile at the studio. Yeah, another exterior. It's not mentioned. No, there's nothing here mentioned about the Batmobile security system, which does get brought up as shot. The rash of car thefts. Yeah, they're going to steal the Batmobile, I guess. some run-of-the-mill car thief. Let's steal the Batmobile. So that's added. And also then later the attempted theft of the Batmobile by Mad Hatter. That's right. Not in here.
You know, I think it was, you know, I'm just trying to defend myself and my poor memory, but I think the reason that I thought that there was a mention of the car theft in the script is because there is mention of the rocket, but the rocket is supposed to be basically the phone bell.
Yeah.
And the car, the anti bat hijacking or Batmobile hijacking device is effectively a set of rockets.
Mm-hmm. Outside the studio, there's a conversation between Dicer and Cappy. Dicer, when they see Batman and Robin, Dicer, the web tightens. Cappy, I just hope it doesn't tighten around us, Dicer. Dicer, don't you trust the boss? Cappy, like I trust women, crossed out. Mad dogs and two-headed viper. Okay, women is moved to the end by Horowitz. Like I trust mad dogs, two-headed vipers, and women. Yeah, well, sexist, but it works better as a line if you put the women last, I guess.
Yes, you know, as I was reading that line, I didn't look ahead to what had been changed at the end. And I thought, oh, you know, this is a little less sexist than I expected. And
then yeah.
You put women in the last position, which makes them, like, you know, the worst of all in terms of the kind of progression. Right. Mad dogs, two-headed vipers, and women.
Yeah. Now, as shot, we just see them outside the studio, but they don't say anything.
Why would they need to?
Yeah. Well, we've gotten rid of that subplot of the...
That's right.
The treachery.
Yes, the treachery of Cappy. Yes. page 24 regarding the sculptor. If Batman has been posing for him, he'd know that the Mad Hatter is a phony. Well, yes, I would think so.
Yeah, I'm trying to think, was that addressed as shot? Because we do have him, well, I mean, he talks about smelling a rat.
Mm-hmm.
So I think we're supposed to gather that he's kind of playing along with the sculptor, mm-hmm. And not quite sure if everything is kosher.
Mm-hmm.
And increasingly feels like it's not. And then he finds Marbeau in the closet.
Yeah, in a way, you know, you really kind of wreck a lot of the show's possibilities if people are able to see through other people's disguises.
Mm-hmm.
Just because they know that person already.
Uh-huh. Well, yeah, I mean, if that's the case, then everybody should be able to figure out the Batman is Bruce Wayne.
Right, or that Jill St. John is not really Robin. I don't know. Anyway, I guess that might be a little more difficult because the mask is so is apparently so perfect that she looks just like Burt Ward.
So here on page 24, here's the reveal of why the sculptor was changed from German to French. Not German accent, any other. We use German with Mr. Freeze. Very good reason.
I guess
we can't have too many Germans on this show.
I'm reminded of a Simpsons line: no one from Germany could ever be evil. No one who speaks German could ever be evil. Anyway, page 25, Batman is apparently going to, yes, he's going to go and take off his cowl, which he apparently is going to do, and Horowitz has written in to the margin, "We have to establish earlier the extreme importance of the statue of Batman, otherwise he'd never agree to this. Maybe Warden Crichton requested it so he could exhibit it at Gotham State Prison to help inspire cons in his rehabilitation program, etc."
Yeah, and that's what happens as shot. In mm-hmm. the dialogue back on page 20, where I was saying, you know, they moved that scene to the Batcave, that's mentioned there. That's for the prison.
Right, right. Although, can you imagine, you know, if I were, not that I'm saying I would ever do this or I would ever be a con whom Batman had put in prison, but if I were a con who Batman had put in prison, I would probably think of lots of other things to do with a statue of Batman rather than revere it and be rehabilitated. But, you know, it fits extremely well with the Warden Crichton's philosophy.
Penological policies.
Yeah. Penological policies, yes.
Now, in this annotated draft, there's a page missing here between 25 yes. and 27.
Holy, page 26.
But if you look at the unannotated version, the page is there. So,
okay. I missed that. I tried to save some time by just reading the annotated version, since they were both the same, or just printing.
Yeah.
I was trying to save a tree.
Right, same here. But when I noticed it was missing, I thought, oh, I wonder if it's in the other one. And yeah, it was there.
So what's on page 26? Let me pull up my file here.
It's pretty much what was shot, I think.
Okay. Gee, this draft is, this copy is so clean.
Mm-hmm.
So un-Horwitzed. Take your place behind the statues as planned. When the boy wonder appears with the cowl, jump him. Got it. Okay. And that's where Batman says, I smell a rat. Got it.
Yeah.
Okay.
And they find the sculptor in the closet. And this is all pretty much a shot.
Right. Okay.
Except that we still don't have the kind of chute of plaster. It's a tub of wet plaster at this point.
Mm-hmm.
It's gotten bigger, but... but it's
the delivery system's not worked out yet.
Right. And since we don't have a mesmerizer for Batman to accidentally reflect into Robin's eyes, instead, Robin is knocked out with the head of Venus de Milo. After a bat fight where the Venus de Milo statue breaks.
Oh, yes, yes, of course.
And Dicer hits Robin over the head with the statue's head.
Mm-hmm.
As Dicer looms in front of Robin with the Venus de Milo's head, Robin raises the Mad Hatter's hat so that its rim points at Dicer's face and squishes the bulb, but nothing happens. Super title. No squirt. No zing. No knockout gas. Title fades as Robin tries again without success. Robin. Darn it. Empty. At this point, Dicer brings the Venus plaster head sharply down on Robin's skull. As an array of colored stars explodes on screen, Robin goes down and out.
As an array of blood and brain matter squirt out of Robin's head after he's hit in the head with a giant alabaster statue. Well, probably just plaster.
Now, we've still got the conspiratorial Cappy here. He wants to dump the plaster on the Mad Hatter. Cappy steps up on a short ladder behind the Mad Hatter with the tub of plaster. Apparently, he's made up his mind to dump it on his leader and then written in, ? Why? It's odd timing that he keeps wanting to attack the Hatter when Batman's around.
Mm-hmm.
It seems like horrible timing.
Yeah, well, confusion, complication, something that the the good Judas figure would probably take advantage of. But still, again, it feels so extraneous, especially after we've seen Horowitz explain why it's extraneous.
So, but Hatter steps out of the way and Batman, he ends up in front of the ladder and he gets it on the plaster dumped on him. And Horowitz wrote in, plant that it's super fast hardening cement. Which makes sense, because otherwise he could just wipe the plaster off. And at first, Hatter is angry. What have you done, Cappy? Now I'll never get his cowl. And Cappy has to talk fast. When the plaster hardens and is removed, you will get a mold of his cowl. And at the same time, Batman will be permanently cemented. A far simpler end than the flailing knives, mechanical stretchers, cylindrical chambers, suction fans, and sulfuric acid spray in your hat factory. Horowitz writes,
so much less sadistic.
This is too much out of character.
Also too much talking. Less chat, more hat.
It's just too much. Now, for some reason, I don't think I ever got this joke. And maybe it's not a very good joke, but where Hatters says, when Hatter is convinced here, and this makes it into the final, two birds with one stone, because the hardening plaster is like stone.
Yes.
But, yeah, anyway.
Right.
And
it's not that funny.
As directed, yeah, the henchmen aren't impressed with the joke. It's the way it's written here, it doesn't seem like it's meant to be a joke. Well, it's underlined in all caps, so maybe it kind of is, but I think, the henchmen don't react.
Well, I think it certainly is. I mean, he says, I can kill two birds with one stone, and then laughs wickedly. Yes, two birds with one stone. So yeah, I think it's definitely meant to be a joke, and maybe part of the joke is that there's no reaction. It's so bad.
Well,
it's a hat dad joke.
Because it's bad, you need to have people on screen reacting to its badness, I guess.
Yes, I suppose so.
Otherwise, it seems like the writers think it's a good joke.
Exactly.
All right. So we've got basically the same cliffhanger. Now, I'm always noticing when they script the opening of part two, what ends up being shot always seems to be 90% different from what the writer wrote. Apparently, somebody at Greenway felt that there was a certain way that those needed to be written and the writers weren't getting it or something. And part two opens pretty much as we've seen it, except, as you mentioned, when Batman only holds his breath rather than using the copper pieces. But it's not hold his breath yet in this version. It's still the copper. And what's this written on page 34? Oh, this is the bit about the Robin being tied to the horse, where he writes, it would be funny if we had him mounted on a horse or some such. Because all that Hoffman has written is that he's lashed to a nearby piece of statuary.
And of course, they did end up using the horse.
Yeah. Crispy Critter wrote on the board, I liked seeing the note in the last version suggesting Robin be tied to a horse statue as a, quote, sight gag, unquote. One of the more memorable visuals in the episode.
Yeah, it works. It works.
Now, I was kind of puzzled by this note that apparently is written on the back of page 35, which for us it comes in as a separate page in the scan.
Mm-hmm.
How about Mad Hatter leaving Batman and Robin and Broomer at end of part one? They have other things to do and will return to get Batman Cowl in a few hours when cement is fully set. Robin and Broomer are tied up. Then at beginning of part two, Batman does his escape bit and then unties Robin and Broomer. So I'm not sure what that was supposed to accomplish.
Well,
Mad Hatter was kind of in the way in the scene.
Well, you know, it kind of makes sense to me, but now that you mention it, I'm not sure why it makes sense. I think it just makes sense in terms of the convention of villains setting up traps and then disappearing so that Batman can escape from them, or yeah, Batman and Robin can escape from them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I suppose that's
unimpeded.
I suppose that's it.
Of course, it makes no sense from a, you know, criminal mastermind perspective that you don't actually, like, stick around to find out whether the trap killed them or not. Their failure lies, I think, and as we've seen in, you know, many, 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 many episodes.
But, yeah, I mean, as shot, that they end up not going with that.
Mm-hmm.
But what's different is that in this script, Hatter tries to shoot Batman rather than just heading for the hills and trying to steal the Batmobile. After failing to shoot him, the Hatter and the henchmen do leave. But yeah, there's this whole long paragraph about a fight at the beginning of part two where after Hatter tries to shoot Batman, and Horowitz writes in, awkward and contrived fight. Escape. Don't need it. And the script also has Robin freeing himself, which doesn't happen.
No, of course not.
And after Hatter and the henchmen have left, Robin says, are you all right? And Batman says, never better, Boy Wonder. That's a no-no. There's something about being cemented alive and then pinned by a 10-ton statue that acts like a tonic on me. Horowitz writes, silly.
Yes, too silly even for, you know, civic optimism, Batman.
Maybe season three.
Possibly. Yeah, I mean, I can imagine Batman saying something about how this kind of adversity, you know, gives you greater strength and sense of purpose or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
But he wouldn't say it was good for him. That wouldn't just be silly. It would be, you know, actionable, I think, or certifiable.
I'm looking at page 38.
Mm-hmm.
I guess they're going back to the Batcave they're about to leave the studio. As Batman and Robin stride out, super title, back to the Batmobile, ... Beneath this, we see Batman and Robin vault into Batmobile and it roars off. Super title, back to the Batcave, ... Beneath this, we see the Batmobile entering Batcave secret ramp. Super title, back to business, ... Horowitz writes, dull. And narration.
Yes. Very, 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 very true. A little bit lower down, Batman, it's crossed out in Batman's line. We can't win them all, Robin. Yeah, well, Batman would never say that either. That's pessimism.
Yeah. Now, this next scene is where they figure out that the jurors are being not kidnapped yet, but having their hats stolen.
Are being targeted, yeah.
And there's a note on page 39. They've got to pin down the number 12 more definitely from some previous clue. Maybe in something last of part one, Jervis said something about Batman's cowl being 13th hat, and that does get added as shot.
Yep.
I wonder what could be keeping Boy Wonder.
Jervis, catch! Your days of crime are over.
Not till I get your cowl, Batman, my 13th hat.
Nice seed planted.
Then Batman is saying, what did he mean by the 13th hat?
Right. let's see, top of 41 or bottom of 40, Robin's line. That's why he wants your cowl, the 13th hat, the incriminating witness. And Batman says ominously on page 41, and just maybe he's planning to get the 12 live jurors to go with those hats. And Horowitz has written, too omnipotent, out of left field. I think he means omniscient.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, Batman becomes Zeus at this moment.
Instead, this is where he says, how could I have been so stupid? And Robin says, all in all, Batman, you've been pretty busy. That's not in here.
That's a good exchange.
And so, yeah, this is pretty much the same as Shot. He asked Gordon for a list of the jurors. But watching this again, I was thinking, like, it seems like, I mean, Batman was involved in the trial, that he would have put together already who these people were, what they had in common.
Yeah, Batman doesn't forget a face. Mm-hmm. And he certainly wouldn't forget a face that was involved in a trial to put one of his deadliest villains, as they all are, behind bars.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I don't quite buy that he wouldn't get it.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, Turkey Bowwinkle now has that name.
Mm-hmm.
B-O-W-I-N-K-L-E.
Bowwinkle.
Now, I admit, as Shot, it's a little hard to catch what he's saying. But, again, it is in the closing credits.
Sure, sure.
Now, remember that bit about needing Adam and Bert to not be on set for a couple of days? I don't know. I'm wondering what it was. Like, did they have publicity appearances or...
Or they just like couldn't that. Afford to pay them to be on set every day, right? I mean, they got weekly salaries, I guess, but that was for a certain number of hours contracted, I suspect.
So, as written, Batman and Robin go to Turkey Bowwinkle's bowling alley and try to place the tracer in the hat. But as Shot, it's Alfred.
Yes.
And so we don't need Adam West and Burt Ward for like 5 or 10 minutes of screen time.
Which is a couple of days of shooting.
Yeah.
Especially with a different set involved.
Yeah. So that's a really interesting reveal that, you know, that was driven by the needs of some kind of publicity appearance or something, not because somebody said, oh, it's a good idea, let's give Alfred something to do. It was first, oh, we need to, Adam and Bert need to do something else for a couple of days. So, oh, I know what we'll do. We'll have Alfred do this.
It was a shooting schedule exigency rather than hey, let's write out Alfred into the script because he's fun.
I wonder how many of Alfred's missions were driven by that kind of consideration.
Yes, who knows? The Alf cycle might have been created under precisely these conditions.
So this section of the script is quite different from what was shot. I mean, the outline of it is there. It's the same goal here, but it's Batman and Robin. And, you know, there's no Alfred and there's no Lisa.
You know, so the conversation, of course, is it takes a completely different turn that, you know, Turkey's very deferential to Batman and they talk about the trial and everything because, you know, obviously Batman knows who he is now and why he's part of this set of targets. But that misses the opportunity that's now in the final version as Shot for Alfred to have to come up with, you know, strange, unmotivated reasons to get a look at Turkey's hat. And Turkey's like, are you loony? So there's you know, that actually a bit of comedy relief that is, not just campy comedy, but you know, like actual comedy that doesn't seem necessarily out of place since Alfred's in an awkward position of, you know, trying to make his mission work and having a hard time of it.
Page 45. Batman, you don't happen to have seen Jervis Tetch around, have you? Turkey, you mean he's out already? Batman, the parole board got generous. Horowitz writes, bad line.
It sounds like something Sam Spade, you know, a Humphrey Bogart played detective would say.
And what I wrote in here was, Batman doesn't throw shade at law enforcement / responsible citizens.
Certainly doesn't. Well put.
At the bottom of the page, 45, Mad Hatter says, Batman's here now, and I suspect a trap, but I'm going to get that bowler anyway, and maybe Turkey Bowwinkle with it. underlined. He'll be the first juror to wear his own hat. Start preparing the ransom notes and tell Dicer to get things going in the hat factory. So, so he kidnaps Turkey here. This is the first kidnapping. Up till now, mm-hmm. it's just been hat nappings.
Mm-hmm.
And Horowitz writes, this is okay if we haven't telegraphed it earlier by revealing Hatter's plan to kidnap all.
Right. You know, this is perhaps a difference between having to write a script and, you know, send it in on time in the age of the typewriter versus in the age of the word processor.
Hmm.
if Hoffman had had a word processor, he could have gone back and figured out how to, like, it's like he's getting the idea as he's writing this draft of the script that maybe Mad Hatter should kidnap the jurors as well as steal their hats. But now he's just like throwing it in wherever he can squeeze it. But whereas if he'd, you know, been writing in a word processor rather than retyping the whole like first, you know, 45 pages of the script, he could have, you know, simply gone back and inserted some material about that and then built on it by, you know, popping it into various parts of the script afterwards.
Yeah. And 46 is the note you mentioned before. Don't like the henchman being against the Mad Hatter throughout. It takes away fun and menace to Batman and Robin. Am I reading that right? Mm-hmm. Is that fun?
Yes, I think so. I think so.
But yeah, it makes sense. You know, a united front is more threatening.
Absolutely, yeah. And also, I think it would, you know, be similarly complicated for the kids to the complication of Batman, you know, filling his, I know this is not what he says he's going to do, but filling his mouth and nose with brass so that he can blow it all out into the plaster you know, create some air holes. It's just too much to think about.
So we get to middle of page 48, where at least...
Wait. We have to say something about this because it fits with one of your motifs for the logic of the show. 46, Batman is still playing for time, sort of gussying up the joint in those way-out threads. And Batman says, just my working clothes, Turkey. And Horowitz has added, just my everyday working clothes, Turkey. And he's written good line, which I think fits with your sense of that motif of Batman and Robin. You know, we wish to attract attention to ourselves, even though their costumes are always drawing attention to themselves. So the everydayness and, you know, nonchalance about the costumes that Batman and Robin are always expressing is, you know, something that Horowitz is capitalizing on here and even making it a better line or a more emphasized line by adding every day.
Yeah, I think just my everyday working clothes. It makes him sound like Joe Lunchpail, who fights crime.
Well, he is just an everyday, ordinary citizen doing his duty, right?
Sure. Right. So middle of page 48 is where, at least temporarily, we rejoin the broadcast version.
Mm-hmm. Already in progress.
With Hatter kidnapping Turkey. Except, of course, he uses the mesmerizer as shot.
Mm-hmm.
But then, like, there's a scene in the actual bowling area, which we never see on screen. And Batman and Robin see Hatter taking Turkey out of the bowling alley with a gun in his ribs.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, we would have seen the bowling alley a few pages earlier if Hoffman had had his way and the bowling pins would knock down. A close-up of bowling pins being knocked down would also knock down the letters in the superscript. There's no comment on that, but I think it's just because, you know, Horowitz has kind of accepted that by now that Hoffman doesn't understand, A, there are no superscripts.
Super titles, yeah.
Super titles anywhere. And B, they have to, like, figure out a way how they can make a living off this show rather than spending it all on special effects.
Yeah, and shooting, like, a lot of traffic scenes where, like, near accidents.
Exactly.
And exterior shots. On 51, Cappy is commenting on Hatter's talking about turning Batman and Robin into hats. So Cappy, as written, says, I told you, and Dicer says, I'm beginning to think you're right. As shot, Cappy is saying he's flipped his lid. And, it, you know, he has not been telling Dicer this before.
Mm-hmm.
This is, like, maybe the only time it comes up.
Mm-hmm.
So that's, we see in the broadcast version kind of a remnant of Cappy being treacherous, as well as the later on in that scene, yeah, but when do we eat? as shot, this is the second mention of presidential headgear, but that's not in the script anywhere.
Right.
Hatter has tied up Turkey and put him in the jury box, which, you know, we never see that on the show. The mm-hmm. tied up jurors are all in the back room.
Right. And the only quote unquote people in the juror box are dummies.
So Batman and Robin arrive out on the street, and Batman climbs up alone, and Robin is supposed to call the police.
Mm-hmm. Why would you want to do that? They'd just call you back and say, Robin, we need you.
Yeah, well, what's funny is that the police never actually show up in the script, whereas as shot, they don't call the police and the police get there.
Mm-hmm.
Batman comes into the hideout by himself, and when he comes in, you know, and it's dark, and he sees Turkey in the jury box, not in the straw, but in the jury box.
Nice.
And says, I'm sorry, Turkey. Now, I thought was interesting was, as shot, Batman approaches the jury box with the 12 dummies in it and says,
I'm extremely sorry about all this, citizens.
And apparently they've decided that in the dark, he has mistaken the dummies for the jurors.
Oh, okay.
So I thought that was an interesting adaptation of what was written.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
When you watch that, it doesn't quite make sense.
Right, right.
Because you know that those are dummies. You've seen them before.
Yeah, I guess I registered that briefly and then just forgot about it. But
well, yeah, I feel like in order to really work as shot, they needed to make it a little clearer that he couldn't see them in the dark well enough to make out if they were real people or not.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But yeah, it just kind of comes and goes so quickly that you're kind of like, why is he apologizing? And then we're off on the fight.
Right, of course.
And so we've got the Hat Factory fight. But Robin, on page 59, leaps in through the skylight.
Hmm. I couldn't find the front entrance, Batman.
also, something I thought was interesting is, in both as written and as shot on 58, Lisa comes in and says, sorry, I'm late. Magda kept the shop open tonight. Batman's right there, but he doesn't say anything. But mm-hmm. as shot, Batman and Robin are both there, and they recognize her from Magda's.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Robin says,
the girl from Magda's!
Up to her pretty neck and evil.
So, I mean, there was so little Lisa in the script that they didn't even remember her.
Right. They, like the viewers of the show, had completely forgotten she exists. But Turkey hasn't forgotten her. There's a subplot drawn in here where Turkey and Lisa were apparently like lovers at some point. Like, holy needless complication. What woman wants to be called Mrs. Turkey Bowinkle, she says. Okay, that's kind of a good line, but again, different show, different series.
So the script has Robin grabbing the turban that's hanging on the wall. As shot, you can't really tell it's a turban. But Horowitz has written, Batman should do this, which he does on screen.
Mm-hmm.
And kind of whips it at the Mad Hatter and his men.
Whips it good.
Da-da-da-da-da. So, but Cappy is still the one who is shooting the sulfuric acid at the Hatter.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And Horowitz has written in, he falls in by accident, I guess Hatter.
Right.
But as written, it says, moving with abrupt bat speed, well, this is Batman. He shoves Cappy aside, leaps through a sulfuric spray valve, turns it off, then approaches the cylindrical chamber, adjusting his gauntlets, opening the rotating core, and quickly withdraws the Mad Hatter's steaming body. At the same time, he shouts over his shoulder, Batman, Robin, turn on a water spray. So he's totally doing the EMT thing here with the Hatter and the sulfur, and taking a little bit too seriously for this show.
Yes, that's right.
You know, it has to be more like a Warner Brothers cartoon where all that it does is make you look a little like charred up, but you're fine.
Yes, as soon as there's a fade to black and a fade up from black, Wile E. Coyote's back in action and all his fur is still on him.
So, yeah, there's a lot of talk about that. Horwitz has written in, police arrive after B&R have cleaned up gang.
Right, of course.
And that makes it into the show, but Robin calling the police doesn't.
Yes, yes.
I guess he called them by telepathy or something.
Well, you know, the police, just having the police show up late is, you know, tells us everything we need to know about the GCPD. So it doesn't matter why they're there, as long as they're not there on time.
And the end of the scene is completely different. Closer at jury box, Batman and Turkey. Batman, I guess you'll be glad to get off this jury, Turkey. Turkey stretches and rises with relief. Like I told you before, Batman, we should have hung him the first time, the worm. Now, he's referring there to a conversation they had in the bowling alley, which, of course, didn't happen as shot. Mm-hmm. So we had to completely toss this out.
Mm-hmm.
And instead, we've got the knocked into a cocked hat bit.
I hope we're not too late, Buster.
We had a devil of a time finding this place.
Oh, that's all right, gentlemen. I'm happy to report that the treacherous schemes of the Mad Hatter have been knocked completely into a cocked hat.
Right.
And
hat snatch fever. Okay.
Then the tag scene, which is basically the same.
Mm-hmm. Buying Aunt Harriet a hat.
Yeah.
For her birthday, is that right? Or just a reward?
It might be birthday. Well, let's see. Yeah, birthday present. Yeah, it's
that's right
here in the script. There's a note at the very end, get Dick in tag scene. Because Dick was hardly, he doesn't have any lines. Not even maybe necessarily in the room. So, of course, he as shot, he is there. The weirdest thing about the scene as written, well, it's more like it's Horwitz's. Okay, so Hoffman writes it as Aunt Harriet being Bruce's aunt.
Mm-hmm.
Magda says to Bruce, it was so nice of you to bring your aunt in, Mr. Wayne. Then Horwitz has written in both she's Robin's aunt and housekeeper.
Right.
So
guess, when have we ever seen Madge Blake keeping house at Gotham or at Wayne Manor? I think this is probably some kind of leftover from the comic. You know, she was.
I was thinking that too.
Yeah, that's you know, she was brought in to kind of heterosexualize, you know, Batman and Robin, or you know, Bruce and Dick. But also as a kind of overseer of their domestic lives.
And she replaced the temporarily dead Alfred.
Right. Right. Before he became a supervillain and was quickly rehabilitated and resurrected. Such a strange story. But, you know, it would have solved everything just to write Robin into the script here so that Magda could look at Dick and say, it was so nice of you to bring your aunt in.
Mm-hmm.
Would have been really easy to just, you know, add some lines for Dick instead of trying to figure out what to call Aunt Harriet's relationship to Bruce. Like she's really, she's his nothing. I mean, she's the aunt of your ward's uncle's nephew's armadillo.
This scene is written a little too long. There's like 2/3 of a page cut out of Bruce and Magda and Aunt Harriet talking.
Oh yeah, this is no tag scene. This is a scene.
Now, the very last line, now this is something I've noticed even just in trying to tell jokes myself, that the way that it was rewritten makes it work better. Because as written, Bruce says, I could have sworn I wore a hat in here.
What's wrong, Bruce?
It's funny. When I came in here, I could swear I was wearing a hat.
Hat is at the end, and that's the funny part of it.
Yes,
so you need to put it last,
right? And it also sounds like emphasis. You know, it's the last word, and you naturally put emphasis on it. So, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, so it became more effective as rewritten.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a really good catch.
Okay, so that is our book-length episode.
Yeah, four and a half hours on the multiple drafts of the 13th Hat.
Hello, I'm Ken Holzhauser, and if you're looking for something new in comic books, may I recommend my newest comic, The Quick and the Dad, a love letter to the DC, Marvel, Archie, and Harvey comics of my youth. This comic has everything. It has spaceships, dad jokes, alien invasions, time travel, supervillains, and so many bad puns. Hopefully you'll like it. It's the cutest comic you've never heard of, and it's available today in print and digital from IndiePlanet.com. That's The Quick and the Dad. Join that other dynamic duo, won't you?
Coming up, Adam West on the show's guest stars and appearances by people who would later become famous, and we read your mail in the Bat Inbox. Help support To the Bat Poles and all the Deconstructing Comics shows with a monthly donation to the Deconstructing Comics Patreon page at patreon.com/deconcomics. For just $2 a month, you get outtakes from every To the Bat Poles episode, plus Paul and I make bi-weekly videos for all patrons, usually featuring a 20th century TV trivia quiz. Or recently we've done some quizzes on pop music. Further perks at higher support levels, including the right to have an ad for your own project on the show once a month, and hours of podcasts on the early issues of The Amazing Spider-Man and on the Marvel Cinematic Universe. And, this coming Saturday on Patreon, at the request of a patron, Paul and I discuss three issues of Batman Confidential from 2009, in which King Tut was introduced to the DC Universe. So go to patreon.com/deconcomics and select the level of your monthly donation. Thanks for listening, and thanks for your support.
We had that infamous Batman and Robin wall walk.
When you think Batman, with people in weird outfits, like the four super crooks hanging around here, it's amazing someone hasn't already reported this place to the police.
Somebody told me at one point that we had 250 guest stars, and among them, people who wanted to do the show, Frank Sinatra, Bobby Kennedy, people like that, and people would pop out of a window, as you probably remember, and it could be anybody from Jerry Lewis to Dick Clark, you know. We had, we had Tallulah Bankhead, Carolyn Jones, Aunt Baxter. There were those who did Batman as, I think, the first jobs. Jim Brolin, Rob Reiner, Terry Garr, Vincent Price as Egghead was wonderful. And one day, as part of the, toward the end of the show, he was supposed to throw eggs. Well, they brought in dozens of old eggs, and he threw a few eggs, and I didn't like it. Bert didn't. Nobody liked it. We started to throw eggs back, and it became this huge egg fight with this terrible, smelly mess of eggs on the stage. It broke the tension, but it was the biggest, most horrible omelet you've ever been in.
All right, ladies and gents, the Bat Inbox. Responses to our episode on Stanford Sherman's Marsha script in episode 177 from the all-seeing, all-knowing 66 Batman message board. Take it away, Tim.
First one is from Chris B. Critter. Might be a stretch, but Alfred's original alias, John McMillan, could have been a reference to the English War Secretary John Profumo and Prime Minister Harold Macmillan, whose political careers were ended by the Profumo Affair sex scandal of 1963.
Oh.
I can see that getting changed when someone at the studio caught it.
Wow, that is so interesting. Never would have thought about that particular scandal, because I know this about the scandal, but I have no names connected to it.
Mm-hmm.
Very interesting.
<Yeah. laughs>
Nice catch there, Chris B. Batwing Hornet. Let's see.
Batwing
Hornet. Batwing Hornet's not too happy about the existence of Marsha Queen of Diamonds. Guys, I appreciate the research and effort you put into every show, but Marsha. Let's just put it this way. When I was a kid, the Marsha episodes were something to endure or avoid, like most of season 3, but it was not enjoyable. Even as a kid, I was well aware of Carolyn Jones from work other than the Addams Family, and based on her abilities, I felt she was not at her best, instead going overboard with that luxurious Lady of Larceny routine. As a bedecked in drag Graham Chapman might put it, don't practice your alliteration on me! By this time in the series, the scripts were not even trying to keep at least 8 of its 10 toes in the action-adventure pool and leaning heavily on sight gags, e.g. the rice-throwing moment with Batman and Alfred, although that's got to be like, you know, of all the campy query moments in the Batman 66 series, that's almost as good as the wedding itself. oh my God, the fate worse than death is Batman marrying a woman! Ah! Let's see, leaning heavily on sight gags that one would have expected on a full-on sitcom such as Gomer Pyle, USMC, or I Dream of Jeannie. I like that you don't just call it Gomer Pyle. You're, you know, going for the full title. That's that's a TV historian for you, aren't we all? And Ed Hilda? Winwood's performance seemed to be a cheap copy of Marion Lorne's Aunt Clara character from Bewitched, and not nearly as sweet a personality. The bad question. Name one villain on the show who you could have done without and how they could have been improved? I will answer here if you don't mind. Well, start with Marsha, or better yet, toss that story, as it was just so tiresome and goofy. A poorly conceived villain on top of that only made the episodes go from bad to awful. Next, I've said this before, but my fantasy recasting would have Carmel's gum booted, replaced by the Joker only if Romero played it like the more sinister version from his first appearance.
Holy upstaging. I mean, you put the Green Hornet and the Joker in a Batman episode?
Wow. Yes, an embarrassment of riches, to be sure. And yes, I could have done without Preminger and Wallach as Mr. Freeze. Both were too over the top, and more than anything, strong examples of how the series was on a creative decline when it had to sell such cartoonish characterizations. In the too easy department, so many season 3 villains should never have stepped in front of the camera, such as Minerva, Louis the Lilac, Lola Lasagna, Dr. Cassandra. Well, I can think of 5 or 6 others, too.
Yeah, well, you know the ellipsis there, after yes. Which comes Nora Clavicle.
Yes, exactly. That was what I was thinking as well. I was like clutching my clavicle as I was thinking about that and shuddering.
So last time I mentioned that I had belatedly found a couple of posts on our own blog at tothebatpoles.libsyn.com. These two were both about episode 166, where we talked about the movie Batman and Robin. One is from Degsy O'Brien, who says, "Hi, guys. Listening to your podcast now as I type this and loving it. You just mentioned the question about the time factor of thawing out Gotham City after Mr. Freeze's attack, that shouldn't the ice melt on its own if it was summer? I think the urgency was because, as established at the start when Freeze zapped Robin, those who are frozen by him have only 11 minutes to be thawed, not 10, not 12, in order to survive. If Batman and crew had left it until morning, sure, the ice would have melted, but Gotham would have started to smell from all the thawing corpses.
But think, it would be like the New Eden. Batman and Poison Ivy could repopulate all of Gotham City together. Well, maybe not.
Yes, a distasteful image, but one perfectly in keeping with this movie. Yes, I'll rag on it like everyone else, but truth be told, I'd watch it again sooner than Burton's overrated offerings." Interesting. Okay.
Yes. And sometimes I wake up feeling that way, too. I was surprised how much I, you know, especially considering how much I just absolutely loathed Batman and Robin on first view back when I actually saw it in the theater. I was surprised by how much I actually, like, genuinely liked it this time around, even though it's awful.
Well, I think, yeah, I mean,
there, enjoyed it, maybe not liked it.
There were things that I unironically liked about it too, but yeah, it's maybe in the so bad it's good category.
Which, we don't want to oversell it,
which was 160's definition of camp. So
exactly. This from JP Pelsman. "I think Uma Thurman has talent and has given good performances in other movies. Oh, yes, Kill Bill 1 and 2 would be a couple of my first choices. But Paul's drag queen comment is spot on. If I have the choice between the Mae West style of femininity and the Julie Newmar style of femininity, give me Newmar every time. Oh, why don't you come up and see me sometime? And that's why I don't like Thurman here. When you're performing at femininity, you're performing, period, and that makes you less of a threat as a villain because you lack gravitas, in my opinion, as she does here. If this movie had been done a bit more seriously, I would love to have seen, say, Julianne Moore in the role. Not only is she also a good actress, but she already has red hair and green eyes. No wigs or colored contact lenses necessary. Extremely good point.
So, our bat question for this episode. Create your own original piece of bat equipment. What was missing from the dynamic duo's arsenal?
I was going to just like come spontaneously with bat scratcher, but I think maybe there was one at some point.
And speaking of bat questions, so if you have any, Forrest, any suggestions, please send them to us in any of the ways I mentioned during the close of the show. And also speaking of bat questions, we got to thinking, we've asked several of these now, but you might be wondering what our answers to these questions would be. So we're going to answer all the questions we posed so far next time. And we'll also discuss an article from Ebony Magazine dated June 1966 about Reuben Watt, an assistant director on Batman.
Yes, very interesting piece of periodical history. And by the way, when Tim mentions questions, he means the kinds of questions like the one he just asked.
The bat questions.
Piece of bat equipment. Mm. Right, you know, what was Batman's favorite color? Probably a little bit too abstract and unanswerable, but the questions we've been asking or that Tim has been posting are good models for the kinds of questions we're soliciting from you to see what others might, how others might respond. Mm.
Well, and you can also send us any regular questions that you'd like us to answer about Batman or our thoughts about it or whatever. So, just listen to the closing here for all the different ways you can contact us.
Excellent.
So, we'll see you again in 2 weeks at the same Bat RSS feed. Apologies for the sound quality on my voice in much of this episode. For some reason, my computer defaulted to the subpar microphone in my headphone cable rather than the much better mic clamped to my desk. We'll be sure to keep an eye on that in the future. Check the show notes for all the 13th Hat documents we discussed, the 66 message board threads on that script and on our episode on Stanford Sherman's Marsha script, and the theme version by Joel McNeely and the Royal Scottish National Orchestra and Chorus. If you have any interesting bat audio that we haven't used yet on the show, or you'd like to make a donation to the show through PayPal, or you just want to drop us a line, the address is batpolls@deconstructingcomics.com. You can also comment on the thread for each episode at 66batman.com/forums, or on our blog at tothebatpoles.libsyn.com. We're on Twitter at Decon Comics and on the Deconstructing Comics channel on YouTube. You can hear outtakes from this and every episode of To the Batpoles and vote for topics for future episodes by supporting us at patreon.com/deconcomics. Also, don't miss our Patreon-only discussion of King Tut's 2009 appearance in the comics series Batman Confidential, coming this Saturday. You can also help us out by shopping via deconstructingcomics.com/Amazon, by sharing our episodes on your social media, and by subscribing to the show on Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen. And spread the word. Let all your friends who are Batman 66 fans know about the show. Next time, we answer some of the bat questions we've been posing to you in recent months and discuss a 1966 Ebony magazine piece on assistant director Reuben Watt. No question about it, we'll be back in 2 weeks. See you then. To the Batpoles is a production of DeconstructingComics.com.